If you took the whole universe and emptied out all of its contents, what would be left? Would there be a pure void, nothing but, well, nothingness? Or is true nothingness just an abstract idea that doesn't square with how things actually are? Is there some irreducible substance to the universe and reality itself? This idea has vexed some of the smartest minds in history, but modern physics is converging on a surprising answer to the question, what is nothing? Imagine a box, sealed, made of thick metal. Now suck out all of the air so that there are no atoms or molecules bouncing around inside. What's left in the box? How about just nothing? True emptiness? Well, there's a problem with that. Say you have two asteroids floating in space, separated by nothing, so that literally nothing was between them. Wouldn't that mean they were in contact with each other? And if not, then what exactly gives the space between them the property of distance? Is that really nothing? One way out of this is to say that there must be an invisible, frictionless medium permeating all of space, serving as a frame of reference. This has at various times been called the ether. Isaac Newton was a proponent of the ether idea. It made it easy to define how an object moves or rotates in space. And James Clerk Maxwell, who united electricity and magnetism, liked the idea too. It was a nice way to explain how things like light waves get around. But it wasn't long until another question arose. If there really is an ether permeating all of space, then it should be possible to measure how fast Earth is traveling relative to it. Problem was, no experiment could measure this speed. And with no evidence to support its existence, the idea of an ether had to be tossed out. This was a victory for the proponents of the pure void idea, but the party didn't last. Quantum physicists like Heisenberg and Bohr discovered that tiny particles like electrons behave unpredictably. For example, you can never precisely know an electron's position and momentum. And what's true for particles is also true for waves and things like electric and magnetic fields. So let's go back to that empty box. We took out all of the particles, and it's made of metal, so no electric fields can be inside. But even though the average electric field inside is zero, at the atomic level, quantum uncertainty means that tiny local fields surge back and forth. Each of those local fields contains energy, which means that even though the fields themselves may cancel out, the average energy in the box is greater than zero. And this isn't just limited to electricity. It's true for all sorts of fields, waves, and even particles. That supposedly empty box actually contains energy. And the craziest thing is that that energy can be, and has been, measured in experiments. So as far as we know, you can never have truly empty space. There will always be energy present. In a way, this is like the old school idea of the ether. It's not an absolute frame of reference, but it does have physically measurable properties. And it may even be the mysterious dark energy that drives the ongoing expansion of the universe. So while the idea of a true void might still make sense as an abstract concept, as far as physics is concerned, there's no such thing as nothing.
In relation to the cosmological argument for the existence of God, if all physical laws came into existence at the same time as the universe did, is it not possible that the fact of everything physical having a cause is not a relevant concept to thinking about before the beginning of the universe? Don't things come from nothing all the time? For example, quantum mechanics.
Okay. If I understand this question right, and it was a complex question, he's thinking of the laws of nature as things, and he thinks these come into existence at the beginning of the universe. And when he said that in the question, immediately a red flag went up in my mind. The laws of nature are not things that come into existence. The laws of nature are either mathematical equations or else they're propositions of a certain form. And as such, they don't come into being. Rather, they become true or false, but they don't come into existence. If these mathematical equations and laws really exist, then they would exist eternally and timelessly. They would never come into being. What they would do is they would become true at the moment of the beginning of the universe when the matter and energy comes into existence. And unless you think that things can pop into existence uncaused out of absolutely nothing, there has to be some sort of a cause that would bring these, bring the matter and energy, space and time into existence. And as for the laws themselves, I would say that these would be belief states in the mind of God, the Creator. They don't exist independently of Him. they would exist in the mind of God as his thoughts or mental states or something of that sort. And when he brings the universe into being, certain of those laws then become true, namely those that describe the reality that he's chosen to create. And in quantum mechanics, you never get things coming into being from nothing. Virtual particles that come into existence, the random decay of radioactive isotopes, all of these have causes. They don't come from nothing. I'm going to be talking with Lawrence Krauss about this on the 13th in the Sydney Town Hall. Why is there something rather than nothing? And Professor Krauss thinks that physics can explain how things come from nothing because he uses the word nothing equivocally to refer to the quantum mechanical vacuum, which is not nothing. It's a sea of fluctuating energy, a rich physical reality governed by natural laws. It's not nothing. In quantum mechanics, you never get something from literally nothing.
Yeah. Okay, we've got two last questions. One's a little bit fun. I'm going to save that till last. Here's the big gun, it seems to me. Professor Krauss and Dr. Craig, you both seem to believe that the universe came from nothing, but you disagree substantially on whether or not nothing is ever really nothing. Please explain.
Well, first of all, there's an incorrect statement there. I don't believe anything. Belief is not a word that scientists use.
Of course you believe something things. You believe what you just said, right?
Okay. Don't you believe that?
Let me explain what science... Things are either likely or unlikely. They're very likely, they're very unlikely. We try and assess the likelihood of something, and if the likelihood of something is near certainty, then you might call it a belief, but it's not a belief. It's not something we say, I believe this, which means that... I have some inner confidence and inner certainty. That is not how science
works.
Let's
go to the question.
So the word belief is not something I'd say about it. Now, in fact, I don't know if the universe came from nothing or began. Okay? What I can show is that everything we know about science is consistent with a universe full of matter, stars, life, human beings, aliens, everything we see, where space and time and laws, when none of that existed before. Now, to me, what you can argue, in fact, you can do your PhD thesis on whether that's nothing, but I don't really give a damn. The point is, the miracle that it seems to me that religion is supposed to try and explain is how this incredible universe of 100 billion galaxies, each containing 100 billion stars, how it could arise if they weren't there in the first place. That seems to violate everything we know logically and everything we think we might know about the laws of physics. What we've learned is, it's not true. It can all come from no space. None of it needed to have existed. And whether that's absolute nothingness is something I really don't care about.
Yeah. When you say that you don't care about it, that's just an autobiographical comment about your personal psychological state.
Fine.
There are others who do care deeply about it.
It's not a...
Including, I think, hundreds of people who will be coming to the Sydney event to talk about this very topic. Why is there something rather than nothing?
But it's just a definition. It's a semantic definition. I describe an initial state. I don't care what you call it. That's semantics.
Okay.
The physics tells me... The physical question is, did those things exist? Did space, did time exist? And by the way, as I say, in fact, one of the many, you heard this during it, this was a William Craig bullshit meter. I hit it every time. He talked about science and got it wrong. The point is, we don't have any evidence, absolutely, that the universe began. Even Alex Vilenkin in that paper said, did it begin? Probably. The point is, there are the very... papers that William Craig's talked about, which I'm sure you don't understand because you don't understand general relativity, in fact, are based on general relativity, which we know breaks down as a quantum theory. And in fact, those presuppositions that there must be a singularity or a beginning, there are many theories like loop quantum gravity, some areas of string theory, the ekpyriotic universe that, in fact, produced an eternal universe that contracts and expands forever and has been around forever. That is consistent with the known laws. We don't know the answer, and we're excited because we don't know the answer, because we've got something to learn. We didn't know the answer to the question before we asked it, like Dr. Craig did.
I really appreciated what you said in your opening speech when you said you have no respect for distortion and misrepresentation.
Yeah,
because
so I don't
call
think me on it.
Anyone has misrepresented the notion of creation from nothing more than you have. In every case, In every case, you are talking about a physical system changing from one state to another. You are not talking about nothing in the sense that not anything. Now, in the case of the models,
I define very carefully what I talk about.
The Born-Guth-Vilenkin theorem doesn't even presume the gravitational equations of general relativity. It is independent of them. And so it will...
At the next talk, we'll discuss the physics of the next paper, okay? We'll discuss the physics of say, loop quantum gravity, which has a bound solution.
Or maybe
the ekpyriotic universe. We'll discuss the statements that, in fact, say that this theorem breaks down.
I'm ready to do it. If you will look at the article I co-authored with James Sinclair, who's a physicist, in the Blackwell Companion for Natural Theology, those very theories that you talk about, pre-Big Bang cosmology, loop quantum gravity, those are all discussed in that article. And Vilenkin discusses them too, and they are not successful models of a past eternal universe.
How do you know? They
won't work.
How do you know that?
Because of the scientific articles that have been published on them, for example.
What about the scientific articles that have been published, in fact, that there are meetings on that talk about an eternal bounce universe? You think all those scientists just happen to like it, and they go to work and work on this because they have some inner belief that the universe is eternal, and they don't mind that it's inconsistent mathematically? That's nonsense.
No, they're working on trying to find a model like that, but so far it hasn't been done.
We just don't know the answer, and I wish you'd just understand that that's a good thing. That's a good thing. Not knowing the answer means there's something left to learn. Certainty in the absence of evidence is, in fact, the source of much of the problems in the world.
When somebody like Alex Vilenkin, who is one of the premier cosmologists of our day, says all the evidence we have says that the universe has a beginning, that ought to make us pause and take that seriously. Now, that's not to say it's certain, but it is to say
it's consistent with our universe having a beginning. If you ask me, what would I bet? I bet our universe had a beginning.
You'd bet what?
I'd bet our universe had a beginning, but I'm not certain of it.
Well,
I know that the
physics.
Hold on. That is my, based on what the physics that I know, I'd say it's a more likely possibility.
Yeah, right.
But it doesn't say the universe had a beginning. It says it's likely. That is a fundamental difference that you don't understand.
Oh, Dr. Krauss, please, please. Any statement you make can be qualified with the prefix probably.
Because qualifications are what science is all about. We qualify our uncertainty.
That's silly.
Is what makes science
that's
so
silly.
Good.
Okay.
There's
okay.
no scientific article that contains the word probably in front of every sentence.
I have a question here. Scott Stevens, are you sorry or are you relieved that you're not moderating the next debate?
Well, I don't want to hear it.
Please, no, just peculiar.
I don't want to hear it.
I'm tired.
I don't want to hear it. It's a lot of baloney.
I'm tired.
It's all right, Jason. You'll be better in the morning. You know you're tired. We're all tired.
I'm tired, and it's a lot of baloney.
You're not tired, Mancini.
one of the most important concepts in philosophy that relates to the being of God and our understanding of the being of God is the Latin concept, or the Latin phrase, ex nihilo nihil fit. And ex nihilo nihil fit basically means this: out of nothing, nothing comes. The idea is, if you take a glass that is full of nothing, and you set it on a shelf, and you leave it for a million years, or a billion years, or however long you choose to leave it, when you come back to that glass that had nothing in it, unless something has been introduced into it, there will still be nothing there. Nothing produces nothing. And here's why that's important in the relationship to our understanding of God. If ever, in the history of the universe, there was nothing, and by that I mean nothing, nothing, in the sense that there was absolutely nothing, no atom, no molecule, no protein, no anything, that if at any time there was nothing, then there would still be nothing, because out of nothing, nothing can come. This is one of the reasons why we believe in a self-existent being. One of the reasons why we believe that God has to be eternal is because we believe that something has to be eternal. We believe that there has to be an eternal something, because if there was ever nothing, if there was ever a time when nothing existed, nothing would still exist today. Because out of nothing comes nothing.